is represented by Elton Gaming & Co. Lead counsel is Dragan Gasek, assistant superintendent Mahmood.
And for the record, it may be worth saying which side each advocate is standing on. Mr. Francis is to our left as the camera looks, is that right? And
yes.
Mr. Gasek is on our right. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Yes.
Gasek.
It's the Christian name that usually causes problems, but it's Dragan Gasek, but it's Gasek, yes.
Okay, thank you. Sitting to the right of the court. Mr. Francis, you are acting for the receiving party, is that right?
That's correct.
I'm in your hands.
Thank you very much, sir. There are three cost orders before you today for detailed assessment. We have the judgment order, the claims cost for the litigation up to the date of the judgment order. That is a total claim for $627,762 plus the assessment fee of $47,082. And that's really the main event for this detailed assessment proceedings.
This is the judgment of the Deputy Chief Justice of the 10th of November 2014.
The judgment, I think, is dated the 29th of October. The judgment order is the 10th of November 2014.
Thank you.
Then we have a cost order under the order of Justice Steele, dated 27th of April 2015. That's a claim for $20,227. I understand there's no objection from the defendant for that costs order to also be detailed assessed at this hearing. Then the third is the order of Judge Omar Al-Muhairi, dated 16th of June 2015. That's a claim for $33,007, which has been agreed by the defendant for detailed assessment today.
Can you say the number again?
$33,007.
Thank you.
The claimants will also seek their costs of the detailed assessment proceedings, depending on how the matters proceed today. That's a claim for $27,195. At the outset, I would say that the claimants and the applicants are concerned, if at all possible, to get everything dealt with today, so that we have one cost order to assist in future enforcement proceedings and what have you. And based on initial discussions with Mr. Gasek, I'm hopeful that we can go through the points of dispute for the main event at quite a clip. I'll start off, unless there are any questions from you, sir, at the outset, I'll proceed with the detailed assessment application for the judgment order costs.
I had a question, which was, do you know when the bill of costs, which is at tab 3 of my bundle, 5th of January 2015 was the bill of costs, then what I need you to confirm, Mr. Francis, is this. And apologies if it's in the bill of costs, I couldn't see it. What I need you to confirm is that the bill accurately reflects the amounts which your client is liable to pay to your firm, and that there are no arrangements in place which will reduce the amount due and payable by your clients, I should say. Let me say that again. I need you to confirm that the bills that we're talking about today, in total, all of the bills, accurately reflect the amounts which your clients are liable to pay to your firm, and that there are no arrangements in place which will reduce the amounts due and payable by your clients dependent on the outcome of this costs assessment. Could you confirm that for me?
I can, sir. I would also point out that in the bill of costs on page 34, we have the appropriate certificates which should confirm the very same for the bill of costs. The certificate as to accuracy.
Those are the UK certificates that I would normally see. We have a further requirement,
sure,
by Practice Direction 5 of 2014 to deal with the situation whereby arrangements have been put in place for invoices to be due and payable at the date of the cost assessment, but with a view that, depending on the outcome, they might be revised, a practice which I understand can sometimes take place in Dubai. So with your confirmation as to the practice direction confirmation, I think we can carry on.
Understood,
thank you.
Sir. Yeah, and the confirmation does extend to that confirmation as well.
Thank you.
The avoidance of any doubt. Okay, I'll proceed with the judgment order costs submissions. I think there are three documents which we should be referring to as we go through the various items in dispute. The bill of costs, which appears at tab 3, the defendant's points of dispute and claimant's responses at tab 5, and then your email, sir, of the 9th of April 2015, which appears at tab 8.
Yes.
With preliminary indications and requests for the defendant's submissions.
Yes. Did those submissions come in, by the way? I can't...
No, sir.
Okay.
Well, that's one of my 20 points.
We'll hear them today.
I'll make just a few introductory points, which I'll go through very, very briefly. Draw the court's attention to the fact that the claims have already made substantial concessions in the sum of $22,569 US. The sum claim, just to confirm, is $627,762 US plus the assessment fee, which has been paid, of $47,082 US. And we would also, if we, depending on how things go, claim the costs of the detailed assessment in the amount of $27,195 US. So those are the sums we're talking about for the main event. You have already anticipated one of the first points, and that is that the defendant has not made any submissions in response to your email of the 9th of April. And we are very concerned that the defendant should not be permitted to raise substantial new arguments or new points of detail today at the hearing. We refer to part 40.35 of the DIC court rules, which states only items specified in the points of dispute may be raised at the hearing unless the court gives permission.
Which rule?
Part 40.35. Having referred to that rule, I would say we don't seek to be overly technical. We just wish to flag that we don't want the limited time we have available in this hearing to be wasted on points of detail which could have been raised and should have been raised by email or in documents well in advance of this hearing.
Mr. Gassick, do you have a rule book with you? Are you 40.35? Okay. Yes, it is a shame that we're here today because we could have saved the paying party quite considerably if settlement had happened. I think the period is within 21 days of the date of the hearing. One wonders if a response to my email of the 9th of April would have achieved that. But anyway, we are where we are today. I am happy to hear a response because I think it's important that we do hear a response. But I know your point that you don't want anything new introduced.
Yeah.
Let's hear what the paying party has to say on the particular points and take it from there.
Yeah, it's not just your email that we rely upon. We also refer at tab 10 to our email to you, sir, on the 17th of May 2015, which is obviously copied to the other side, where we requested a direction that the defendant serve any substantive submissions in response to your 9th of April email well in advance of the hearing today. We suggested a date of 24th of May 2015, but the point was really just to flush out if there were any points of substance or detail in order to narrow the issues in dispute and potentially avoid the need for this hearing today. And there was no response.
Well, I apologise for that, not because this is the first I saw this email was when I saw the bundle. It wasn't put before me either. So let's see what's said and we'll take it from there.
Okay, moving on to the detail of this application. I suggest we use the points of dispute and the responses at tab 5 as the starting point and then cross-refer for each point to your email at tab 8. And then I suggest that we take submissions from both sides to the extent parties want to add to their written submissions and then allow you, sir, to make a note of your findings or give your findings if you're in a position to do so.
Smashing.
So if we can start with tab 5, page 2. This is preliminary point 1
mm-hmm.
on proportionality.
Mm-hmm.
Tab 8 in your email, and I'll quote it so you don't have to continue.
I've got it. It's really for the paying party now to set out any objections they have on point 1, isn't it?
You indicated in that email, I do not find that in general terms the claimants' costs are disproportionate or unreasonable. Claimants agree and have set out their written submissions. We don't propose to add to that those written submissions at this stage. We note that this is just a general complaint that's made by the defendant and no specific costs are challenged in this point. So we would suggest that there's no need to dwell on preliminary point number 1 at this hearing today. But I'll pause in case Mr. Gassett wishes to make any submissions.
Yes, I do. Registrar, from the outset, I may be excused for perhaps an awkwardness in my style. This is my first appearance before the GIFC courts.
You're very welcome.
So I ask for some indulgence in terms of inaccurate references or use to the Australian jurisdiction. So any issues concerning assessment of costs and applicability would be drawn from my experiences in that jurisdiction. Now, in terms of proportionality, and I know what my friend says about if there were any questions concerning proportionality or reasonableness that would have been raised, the submissions that we, or the points of dispute that we provided in our written submissions, do contain a general complaint that the question of proportionality is something that was to be discussed today. One of the issues, and I think I spoke to my friend about the way that I was going to propose, and I might as well deal with it on the preliminary point, because most of my arguments concerning the balance of the bill of costs go to the question of proportionality and also reasonableness. And the reason why I say that is that on the claimant's own evidence, they effectively set out what they represented to the court were reasonable costs and fees for a particular application. And I draw your attention to a statement of costs that the claimants provided to the court on the 3rd of February 2014. And I asked my friend to bring a copy of those.
I think, if I'm just going to interrupt, I think we can cut short these submissions. We do have one correction and one concession to make in respect of the period which Mr. Gassett is just moving on to. So I don't think we need to have detailed submissions on that statement of costs at this stage.
The reason why I'm making these submissions, and I think it's important for the court to understand when, despite the concession, what I'm seeking to show is that we have a statement of costs for the work performed by the claimants in relation to an unlisted application made by the defendant, and it was filed on the 19th of January
2014.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And the issue concerns 14 days of fees that the claimants incurred in responding to the defendant's application. Now, the claimant's solicitors, Alan and Overy, confirmed their instructions on the 21st of January 2014.
Mm-hmm.
No real work started on the unlisted application when you go through the bill of costs until on or about the 29th of January 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So you will note that the statement of costs was filed with the court on the 3rd, and in there was an itemised breakdown of what hours were spent by Mr. Francis and his assistant at the various stages of meeting with his clients, dealing with other documents and other work, and the time proposed for hearing. Now that, in my submission, sets out what Alan and Avery thought was reasonable at that time. It was $12,500 odd. $8,000. The court, at the end of the hearing, I think, awarded some $8,000 in costs recoverable in respect of the claimant's response to our client's application.
Mm.
But when you actually go through on an item-by-item basis from the 29th of January 2014 up to and including the 3rd, the total amount of costs incurred and proposed to be charged to the claimants
mm-hmm.
was $44,000.
$44,000.
Now,
okay.
I thought that was a little bit curious. And I thought, well, how can that be? I mean, from my perspective, when I prepare a bill of costs for my client, it's usually in the system. And I enter that time contemporaneously. So I assumed that whatever was drawn from Alan and Overy's computer system was an accurate reflection of the time actually spent on or about the 3rd of February. And that appears evident when you look at the bill of costs, because there is some time entries put in preparing the statement of costs submission. So where did that additional time come in? Did it, was it waived? Was it put in post 5th of February? I'm not quite sure how that lost time, how that could have been lost. So there is that, you know, significant discrepancy, some 3.5 times the difference between what the statement of cost shows and some 5.5 times more than the amount actually awarded by the court. Now, in light of that, how can the assessment, or how can you, as the assessor, make a confident assessment on whether the fees incurred are proportional or reasonable when you have a statement by my friend's law firm that says, well, we actually represented the court that $12,000 was a reasonable amount? So I really don't know. So it's $44,000,
$15,000,
and
$12,000.
The other issue...
Help me with this. I don't think I've understood your point. Are you saying that the time on the clock was $44,000, but the submission to the court in terms of recovery was 12 and a half, and
yes.
the court ultimately awarded eight?
Yes.
So, or in broad terms. So are you saying that the time on the clock... In your submission, the time on the clock at $44,000 was understood by Allen and Overy not to be reasonable and proportionate, which is why they only asked for 12 and a half. Is that what you're telling me?
Well, I'm asking you to look at it in a way where I can't understand the discrepancy between the time in the statement of 12 and a half thousand and time on the clock at 44.
So why, are you asking me to find out why did Allen and Overy discount their fees for the purposes of the assessment, the immediate assessment, from time on the clock at 44 to a request for only 12 and a half? Is that what you're asking?
Not only that, but what I'm asking you to consider is that the time claimed is the proportional amount of time that ought to have been reasonably extended for that particular application. Because when you look at the statements that were actually prepared, the documents that were prepared, there was one statement from the claimant's side, and that was Mr. Mostert, and that was a 13-page statement with some 26 pages of annexures that were just correspondence. And then a skeleton argument that was 13 pages long. So one would have assumed that in responding to our client's evidence, $12,500 is a reasonable and proportionate sum. And it's reflected in that initial statement. But then you see the bill of costs, and it's 44. Mr. Francis, I think, claimed 50.2 hours from the 29th until the 3rd, or the 5th at the hearing. And when you look at the entries, there's some of those entries are 7 hours and 36 minutes for preparing for the attendance on trial, and meeting with the witness and an email. And that's sort of what happens to determine whether that amount of time was reasonable or in preparing for the attendance hearing. So there's confusion on my part whether the test of reasonableness in my submission is what's contained in the statement of submission costs.
Okay, so you're asking me to introduce an element of doubt as to whether time on the clock is reasonable and proportionate, given that in the past it's been felt that time on the clock had to be reduced even by the receiving party because it wasn't reasonable and proportionate. Is that the inference you're making on this general point that we're dealing with?
Yeah,
now?
That's the inference that I'm making.
Okay.
So that's on the question of proportionality, and I will develop that argument further as I draw you to particular entries in the bill of costs. And they're not going to be long. They're only going to be three or four references that I will take you to, and invite you to look at the global amount claimed in a rather sceptical view, and I'm asking you to apply a discount on the actual amount that's claimed, because the qualities of the entries are not of sufficient detail to make you feel confident that the time claimed is the time that was actually spent. So, and I'll do that, I guess, when my hearing finishes.
As we go through. All right. Thank you.
So perhaps I can respond very briefly to the points that have just been made by Mr. Gassett. So you've identified the two key questions. Why did Allen & Overy put in a statement of costs for that application for $12,500 when the time on the clock was $44,000? And secondly, should you use those facts as a basis for drawing some sort of inference that we've overcharged or been disproportionate in our claim for costs in our detailed bill of costs? Starting with the first question,
I'll rephrase the second one. I don't think there's a suggestion of Allen & Overy overcharging at all. I think I think the suggestion might be that with a firm of the quality of Allen & Overy, you will have systems and layers in place for your client, which may lead to a higher amount of the bill than is reasonable and proportionate to pass on to the paying party. I think that's what I heard anyway. Rather than them suggesting that you're overcharging, I
apologize, sure. I meant to say overclaiming.
Yeah, thank you.
You're absolutely right. First of all, this was the period of time was from the 29th of January to 5th of February for the statement of costs. It was from the date of a without prejudice, or I think it might have actually been an open offer, which was rejected. So it was for a shorter period than the period that Mr. Gassett has identified. Secondly, it was for immediate assessment rather than detailed assessment. We were the new lawyers who had just been appointed on this case, and we immediately identified that a marker needed to be put down, if at all possible, on costs, that applications as weak as the unlessored application should not be made. We appreciated that it would be very difficult for the DIFC courts to make an immediate assessment order at such an early stage in the proceedings, and therefore we put in a deliberately conservative statement of costs in order to increase the prospects of us achieving that objective of getting a marker put down on costs. Secondly, there was a second objective to putting in a very conservative statement of costs for that period, and that is to flush out whether or not the defendant would in fact honour any order from the DIFC courts. We strongly suspected he wouldn't, and as a result of us obtaining that order, that suspicion was vindicated. So there were cogent reasons for why we put in a very conservative statement of costs. There is a further point which has not been raised by Mr. Gassett, but I think I'll anticipate just in case it is brought to your attention as we go through the documents, and that is we have a correction or concession to make in respect of the 5th of February order which granted us those costs. If I could just hand up a copy to pass to you. We have discussed with our senior cost lawyers in London, who put together the bill of costs, how they addressed the impact of that cost order and that cost award in the bill of costs. We've also gone back to check the transcript of the hearing of the hearing that took place on the 4th or the 5th of February before and the Deputy Chief Justice. And that has confirmed to us that we need to make a correction to our bill of costs in order to deduct all the time claimed for documents from the 1st of February to the 5th of February. It's reasonably clear after looking at the transcript of the hearing that the Deputy Chief Justice assessed all of our costs for that period, rather than our original interpretation, which was incorrect, which is that he only assessed 50% of our costs for that hearing. So that results in a deduction to our bill of costs of $31,170.90. So that's an additional point which I anticipate Mr. Gassick may have raised later in his submission, but even if he did not, we always intended to draw this to the court's attention, because properly it should not have been included in the bill of costs. Now, on the second question about what inferences you should draw from the difference between the time Alan Lowe has spent on that 5th of February application and the time in the sending of costs, well, we would say it's uncontroversial that if a party is applying for immediate assessment, they should put in a conservative statement of costs if they wish to increase their prospects of obtaining an immediate assessment and costs order on the day. And that the party should not be criticised for that. And I've already gone through the other two objectives which we stand by and which were of value to the claimants. And again, we say the claimant should not be criticised or penalised for having taken that approach, especially not in light of our voluntary concession and clarification. That's the end of my submission in response to that point.
Thank you.
And unless there's anything further, I'll move on to preliminary point two.
Thank you.
Okay, so tab five, preliminary point two, page four is on hourly rates. And so your indication at tab 8 is, I'm comfortable that the claim rates are reasonable and proportionate. Claimants agree and have set out their submissions in writing at tab 5, page 5, but nothing further to add at this stage. And if the defendant has no further submissions on this point, I suggest that we move on, but I'll pause.
Thank you. I'm just looking up now. So we've got them all in front of us. Counsel for both sides to open their rule book at rule 38.21. And let us, because I think it frames the context for today's hearing, take us through the factors to be taken into account in deciding the amount of costs. 38.21.1 deals with assessment on a standard basis, and I believe we're assessing on a standard basis today. 38.22 says we must give effect to orders which have already been made. 38.23 says we have to have regard to, amongst other things, the conduct of all of the parties, the amount or value, the importance of the matter to the parties. I think three is quite an important measure for the purposes of our assessment today. The complexity of the matter, the difficulty or novelty of the questions raised, the skill, effort, specialised knowledge and responsibility involved, the time spent, and the place where and the circumstances in which work of any part of it was done. We then need to turn to rule 1.6. Now in my rules I think the reference is wrong. But if we were to look at proportionality at 1.63, proportionality is proportionate to the amount of money involved, the importance of the case, to the complexity of the issues, and to the financial position of each party. And rule 38.24 goes on to say about the relationship between the total of the costs incurred and the financial value of the claim may not be a reliable guide. A fixed percentage cannot be applied in all cases to the value of the claim in order to ascertain whether or not the costs were proportionate. And then 38.25. In any proceedings, there will be costs which will inevitably be incurred and which are necessary for the successful conduct of the case. Legal representatives are not required to conduct litigation at rates which are uneconomic. Thus, in a modest claim, the proportion of costs is likely to be higher than in a claim, in a large claim, and may even equal or possibly exceed the amount of dispute. So it's important to have all our rules in context, but I hope it was helpful just to refresh ourselves against those guidelines as we now move into the specific assessment criteria, as we move away from the preliminary points into the specific assessment criteria. Mr. Gassick, on point two, do you have any submissions? Preliminary point two.
I won't go over and above what is the outcomes of dispute. I propose to deal with a global approach that I will be submitting that you take in relation to assessing the items.
Thank you. Well, I remain of the view that the claim rates are reasonable and proportionate.
So if we can move on to preliminary point three, which is on council's fees. This is tab 5, page 5. The claimants have provided council's fee notes, which appear as the last two pages in this tab.
Mm-hmm.
Your indication in your email at tab 8 is, I require the defendant's submission, now it has seen the fee notes. So I'll pause for the defendant to make any submissions.
Thank you.
Extent fee notes contain an overall brief fee of £38,000 with £6,000 refreshing fees for each day.
I've got £4,000.
Oh, I'm just sorry.
Okay.
To have a brief fee for each of those days to get a bit of refresher appears to me to be unreasonable. It's not something that I'm certainly coming from where I come from would be claimable in terms of council's fees. If I'm charging a brief fee for a day, how then can I claim a refresher fee of $4,000 for a hearing day? It just doesn't make sense to me. Maybe it just operates differently in the UK bar, but it's almost like a double up on the fees. You get your brief fee as well as a refresher fee for the same day.
So is your position that the brief fee is reasonable and proportionate, but the refresher fees are not?
Not in respect of the 4 days.
Help me with your, what would you consider to be reasonable and proportionate?
Well, the daily brief fee. The daily brief fee ought to take into account the work required for a particular hearing day.
So So the £16,000 is in your view is reasonable and proportionate, but the £38,000 is not.
No. Yes.
Is that your?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So when would you have expected council to read into the dispute? How would council be paid when they're preparing for the trial?
It's the manner in which the bill was prepared. I mean, the refresher fee is charged for the, and presumably the refresher fee was incurred on the day of the hearing.
If I've understood it, well, we'll hear. Let's hear about how the refresher fees were incurred.
Yeah, at the moment, as it reads, it was only council being paid for attending the hearing on the 19th of May,
mm-hmm.
but also the refresher fee for the same day. So I really don't know when council was charged the reading in fees. I mean, one would assume that that would have been incurred prior to the briefing, the hearing briefing. Certainly, in my understanding of it, when I'm sending out a bill as council, I would be setting up the reading time prior to any briefing, beforehand, and not on the day of the hearing. Now, I couldn't justify to a client that I'm charging you for, say it's £5,000 for a day of briefing, and charge you as a refresher for the same day, in the amount of £4,000.
So I've got this. We're not a part that council should be, we're expecting to see charges for council reading into the
absolutely,
case.
Absolutely.
And is your view that the £38,000, which is the reading in, the briefing, the preparation for the trial, should include the days of trial? Is that what you're saying?
No, I understood the bill as I'm looking at it.
Yeah.
That the £4,000 has been charged as a refresher for the hearing fee. On top of the hearing fee. That's how I'm reading this invoice.
We may have different invoices. Let's double check. I've got an invoice, Mr. Damien Brown, brief on which.
I've got an invoice here from Littleton Chambers,
£38,000. Brief on hearing listed to commence 18th May. And that date on mine, assuming it's the English way of writing it rather than the American, is 2nd of May 2014. And then I've got a second page invoice. I've only got two pages. And the second page then, I thought, perhaps wrongly, dealt with the hearing, which I'm assuming, looking at it, took place on the 19th, 20th, with a day off on the 21st, and then back in on the 22nd. That's the way it looks to me. Am I going wrong on this?
Perhaps it's the descriptor which is incorrect, which has got me confused, because it's a refresher.
Perhaps I can just clarify.
Yeah.
There's a brief fee which goes from the moment of instruction of QC up to the end of the first day of trial,
mm-hmm.
which is the brief fee. And then there is a refresher fee, which is standard for UK Council for each day of the hearing. So that's how the two invoices are broken down.
So if that's a standard for UK Council, I can't speak to it. It seems curious to me that a refresher fee, £4,000, should be charged on top of a daily brief fee that has already been charged and claimed.
Yes, I understand. I understand the confusion.
Yes.
I understand now. You thought there was £38,000, which was the brief fee for the hearing,
yes.
plus refresher fees for the hearing.
Yes.
Yes, I understand. And actually, it looks to me as if the brief fee is the instruction to counsel and the work
yes.
done up to trial.
Yes.
And I was interested, actually, Mr. Francis, you said it included the first day of trial. So the first day of trial was the 18th, was it?
Yes, it was, which is why on that second
Understood.
Invoice, you'll see that there's no amount charged for the 18th.
I see.
It's just the four. The three active days and the one non-sitting day. So there's no overlap or duplication in terms of time.
Exactly. If that was the case, I might as well go to London. There are a good wicket.
You won't be alone as an Australian.
I might know Mr. Gassett will get a lot of business if he's charging £16,000 for a week-long trial.
Okay. Well, on that basis, can we move off this?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, if we can move on to preliminary point four.
So,
tab 5, page 6. Which is alleged duplication between team members. So
yep.
Your indication at tab 8 is, I'm comfortable with the distribution of work between fee earners. The claimants agree, and we've set out our submissions in writing at tab 5, page 7.
Mm-hmm.
So if the defendant has nothing further to add, we can move on. But I'll pause for the defendant's text and submissions.
Nothing to it.
Thank you.
Okay, very good. Okay, we can go to items 5 and 6, which is tab 5, page 7. The claimants have made a full concession, and so your email at tab 8 records no decision required. I think we're agreed with that, so I think we can move on.
Yes, it's fine.
Good. Okay, moving on to items 10 to 12, 14 to 16, 18 to 20, 23 to 25, which is tab 5, page 7. And this is about time for Alan Overy's representatives attending the hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And so in your email at tab 8, you have stated, although I might be persuaded that Mr. Roderick's time should be discounted or removed, I'm comfortable with the attendance of Mr. Francis and Ms. Habib. We have very brief submissions in respect of Mr. Roderick's time to add to the written submissions in the response to the points of dispute. We say that at least part of Mr. Roderick's time should be awarded, since it cannot be reasonable in our submission to expect that the partner on the matter will not attend parts of the trial, particularly where senior members of the client are attending and also appearing as factual witnesses for cross-examination. And if we turn in tab 3 to the bill of costs,
mm-hmm.
pages 7 and 8 of the bill of costs,
yeah.
If you look at item 10 and item 14, item 18 on page 7,
mm-hmm.
and then over the page, and also item 23, it should be apparent from the time differences between Mr. Roderick and other members of the team that he did not attend any full day of the hearing. He was only ever attending parts of the hearing in order to perform his, what we say, is a distinct role at the trial. So those are my brief submissions. I'm allowed to try and persuade you to award all of Mr. Roderick's time, or at least part of Mr. Roderick's time for trial. I'll pause for the defendant to make submissions.
Thank you.
Well, there was no latent work being undertaken on this one other than appearing in court. The claimants shouldn't be allowed to claim those fees, because if it was just a supportive role to ensure the appearances for the sake of clients, then that's a decision that Darwin Mowbray chooses to make in terms of its marketing. But otherwise, unless there was some active, instructive role played by a partner, I would be submitting that should not be required.
How many hours are you claiming for Mr. Roderick in terms of his attendance?
I think on the first day of the hearing, we've got 4 hours.
Yeah.
Second day, 3.5 hours.
Mm.
The third day, 2.5 hours.
Mm.
And then the final day, 3 hours.
$13. At what rate?
At $819 per hour. Informing me that the total sum claimed for Mr. Roderick's time is $10,647.
And the question for us is whether I absolutely understand why the senior partner would want to be here with clients, and I understand why they would want to understand how proceedings are developed. And one assumes Mr. Roderick is the relationship partner as well for the client. So I understand that. And we're not having to decide whether his attendance is reasonable and proportionate. What we're deciding is whether it's reasonable and proportionate for that cost to be borne by the paying party. I can see that it would be important for the case to have the lead partner present at key moments, but I'm not persuaded that the paying party should pay for Mr. Roderick's entire attendance, the 13 hours or so. If Mr. Roderick were to have attended at the opening submissions and at the closing submissions, how much time would that have entailed?
I think that's exactly what he did attend, and so it's very easy for me to calculate. It's four hours on the 18th of May, and then 3 hours on the 22nd of May.
So I'm going to allow 7 hours. I'm going to, in essence, halve Mr. Roderick's time. I'm going to allow 7 hours, because I do feel that the presence of the lead partner is of value to the litigation for the opening and closing submissions, but I'm not going to allow his attendance on the intervening days, insofar as I don't find it reasonably proportionate for the paying party to pay for that attendance, although I do understand and appreciate why Alan Overy took the view that it was important for the partner to attend.
Thank you, sir. I'll move on to item 29, which is the category attendance on the claimant, which is tab 5, page 8. The defendant in the points of dispute sought clarification on these discussions but did not set out any specific concerns. However, the claimant made full concession in response to the defendant's offer, which amounts to a deduction which has already been incorporated in our claim of $5,658. Your indication, sir, at tab 8 is, I should be grateful for the defendant's response to the concession. So again, we'll pause for the defendant in case they wish to add.
In relation to attendances generally, my submission is that any individual attendance is providing advice or taking instructions that are essentially over 4 units should contain some detail concerning what those attendances were about, concerning how the case was developing or being progressed. So I'm asking you to consider whether those items, where it's over 4 units, unless there is sufficient information, then I would be submitting that anything over and above that with insufficient detail should be kept at the 4 units.
Do you want to take us through the specifics of that? Which attendances are you concerned about?
If I can draw your attention to an example. To page 17 of the appeal process. But this is just by way of an example.
Thank you.
Where it says preparation for attendance at hearing, preparing for calls and updating the email.
So that's not item 29, that's on documents. Ms. Gattick needs to refer to, I think it's pages 8 to page 10, which is the item that we're talking about now.
I'm going to make a global submission in relation to attendances generally, and it should not be limited just to those items of points.
Let's deal with item 29 first. Item 29 is attendance upon the claimant, and that is, it looks to me, page 10 and leading on to 11 of the bill of costs.
So it goes backwards. Sorry, sir.
Has it gone back?
That's the summary. It starts on page 8, after item 28, and the conclusion summary is page 10.
That long, was it a meeting concerning the preparation of witness statements? Was it a meeting concerning the production of documents? There's just insufficient detail. There is nothing here except making a change.
You're going to have to help me again. Misheard. Are we starting? Where are we starting the review of item 29? The point that we're working on. I've got the bill of costs here.
It starts on page 8, sir.
Page 8, where it says instructions item work done.
Exactly. Claimants 2014, and all of that page, all of the next page, page 9,
yeah,
and all of page 10 up to and including the summary.
So we're talking about a period from the 20th of January until the 28th of October.
The whole proceeding's up to date of judgment.
And during that time, we're talking about 32 attendances covering 44.2 hours, and your client has already given concessions of $5,658 to that time.
Yes, sir. That's correct.
Your position is it's not clear what those attendances were. You don't have the notes. Would you expect to see the, from a privilege point of view, would you expect to have those submitted to you for the purposes of cost assessment?
No, I would be submitting them what needs to be supporting these amounts claimed. It is a brief detail for example, the 4 hours on the 29th of January, page 8, what that was spent on. I mean, it would either be spent in preparing written statements or going through the evidence of the defendants, for example, or taking instructions on particular discrete points. It would involve legal professional privilege, but certainly indicate whether the 4 hours that was spent was actually reasonably spent. It could have been that they were out for lunch. We don't know. We simply do not know, and what I'm submitting,
yes,
to registrar, that anything that is over 4 units or 24 minutes in length ought to have a reasonable amount of descriptive or substantive descriptor as to the nature of the work undertaken during the meetings. There's simply nothing here. You're asked to guess, you're asked to fill in the gaps as to whether or not that time spent was reasonable in proportion. You simply cannot make that determination.
So, if I can just respond very briefly. The bill of costs is prepared by a senior costs draftsman in our London office. I understand that this is exactly the sort of detail that you would expect to see before the English courts for a bill of costs in the section concerning attendances upon the claimant. There's certainly no question that claimants are not claiming any time spent at lunch or any sort of marketing or social occasions, as you have anticipated. So the attendances are to take instructions, give legal advice, which is subject to privilege, and to update clients on the progress of litigation, discuss strategy points, and deal with their concerns. It does not include preparation of witness statements. That time is recorded under the documents category. I would add some further submissions on proportionality, which I'll give very briefly. I think it's common ground that complex issues were raised by the defendant in his proceedings. Very serious allegations were made by the defendant against senior members of the company, including allegations of dishonesty, which were completely unsubstantiated. There were multiple interim applications for document production, for the production of extensive volumes of the claimant's business records, and as you said, already noted, we have already made a concession, which we say is substantial in light of the unspecified objections. And we would say that the summary of the time recorded, and we've got 4 hours and 4.5 hours of Mr. Roberts' time, we've already conceded 0.9 hours of that. 22.5 hours of my time, we've already conceded 7.1 hours of that. Ms. Habib's time of 17 hours and 12 minutes, we've already conceded 0.4 hours of those times. If you take those totals, we say that is entirely reasonable and is actually very low for attendances on a client for a complex litigation proceeding over the course of the best part of a year, so from January to end of October.
But Mr. Gassick's point is, if I've understood it, there is no detail in here for us to understand what the time spent doing, just attendance on client. And what he's asking is that, on as it is standard basis, in the case of doubt, one might ordinarily find in favour of one ought to find in favour of the paying party. And his suggestion is that there is sufficient doubt in his mind that he's asking us to discount the time up to anything after 4 units per interaction. So I think it's the level of I don't think there's any suggestion that the time wasn't spent, but it's without the level of detail. I think he's asking for us not to allow for anything more than 4 units per engagement. So how do you do the level of detail point?
I've already addressed what is normal in terms of a bill of costs, at least before the English courts. So we say we should not be penalised for having set out what is the usual level of detail. Secondly, any specific concerns about adding specific times should have been identified well in advance of this hearing. We would have been in a position to look at, say, a 4-hour meeting or a 2-hour meeting and make a decision as to whether or not we needed to disclose in broad terms what was discussed or what the purpose of that meeting was. The fact that we have not been put in the position to be able to address those specific points, we say, should lead the court to refuse to undermine our claims for those times.
Thank you.
Just on the final point there, really strong.
Thank you.
The court can, of its own emotional volition, look at these items and determine for itself whether or not these items are reasonably proportional in accordance with Part 38.21. And if the bill of costs...
Hang on a second. 38.21.
Yes. Now, if the court is to have regard to all the circumstances, it can't do so on the basis of the information that's been prepared in London.
Mm.
It simply just doesn't lend itself. And if this is the way it's done in London, well, it certainly doesn't fit into the requirements that are needed to be considered by the court on the assessment, or the assessor for the purposes of 38.21.
Well, Mr. Gassett does make a good point, which is we are not able to see from the bill of costs the exactly why that time was spent. However, on balance, the paying party had the opportunity to raise this and ask for more detail since the filing of the bill of costs, and was further invited to make their submissions by way of correspondence dated the 9th of April, and chose to do neither. That is not an answer in itself, but having taken account of the concession made by the receiving party, the amount claimed in respect of attendance in a matter of the seriousness for all parties of this case for the period from the 20th of January until the 28th of October is, to my mind, reasonable and proportionate. Is to my mind reasonably proportionate in amount, and was reasonably and proportionately incurred. So I allow the amount requested less the concession.
Thank you, sir. I think we can move on to item 34, which is attendances on the previous solicitors for the claimants. That's at page 5, sorry, tab 5, page 9.
Mm-hmm.
Your initial indication at tab 8 is no decision required, so I think if that's agreed with all parties, I think we can move on to the next item. So I guess it's not shipping the paper.
The reason I'm not, Alan and I first appears on the 21st of January. Now, they did some work beforehand with the previous solicitors. And they're claiming some $18,000 under the bill of costs for those fees for dealing with discussions with the lawyers, reading into the matter. But my submission is that why should the defendant be charged for those fees, effectively for costs thrown away in re-educating yourself on the matter, due to a forensic decision made by the claimants to change solicitors.
I'm looking at page 13 of the bill of costs. This was time spent doing what?
This was handover from the previous solicitors, so basically an update on where they'd got to and what they saw as the key issues. I would add that this is a new objection. If they're going to contest my time, that's not in the points of dispute and should not be properly before the court today. They've made a point of dispute, we've given a full concession, that should be the end of the matter. However, the court does have the discretion, of course, to allow any point of raise it. If it sees fit, we say it's not appropriate to do so. We're only talking about an hour of my time as well, so perhaps it's not worth spending too much further time on it.
Thank you. I mean, the paying party offers the attendance of YF. That, so we're only talking, aren't we, about the attendance of Mr. B? Well,
that's been conceded, sir. It's a new point. It seems
that's
to
why
be
I thought
we'd, one hour
I thought
of
we'd
time.
Dealt with it.
There is a flow on. Argument that the claimants can only get back what they're contractually entitled to pay. Now, if the retainer agreement does not cover fees prior to the retainer agreement, all those fees that are claimed beforehand, there's no contractual entitlement. That's why we asked Allen & Overy to produce their cost disclosure retainer agreement.
But then they would have signed an incorrect certificate, which would be a very serious matter. So let's not go there. On this point, the defendants offered Mr. Francis's time, and the receiving parties conceded everything else.
Sure.
Is that so? Can we move on?
I'm happy. I wanted to raise that point.
Thank you.
Some $18,000 has been claimed for pre-retainer work.
Mm.
Now, I think the court ought to be satisfied that there's a contractual entitlement to charge that.
Let's see if that comes up as we go through. Thank you. Okay, thank you.
So if we can move on to item 35, which is tab 5, page 9. These are the fees that were paid by the claimants to the previous lawyers, Cotty.
Mm.
We have a correction to make here. We have gone back to look at the fee note that was submitted by Cotty, and we identified that a court fee and Cotty's fee note were transposed in the bill of costs.
Mm.
So if I can take you to tab 3 so you can note the correction, page 5.
Yeah.
The paid court fees were actually $4,850. I'll just hand up to the assassin the evidence of the payment of court fees.
Is this item?
This is item 1.
Item 1. So it wasn't 6,000, it was 4,850.
Yes, exactly. And then if we turn to page 13.
Right.
The item 35, the 4,850 should in fact be 6,000. So it makes no difference to the overall sum.
I see.
It simply was an error, an administrative error by our cost team in London. Your preliminary indication at tab 8 was that you require the defendant's submission now that it has seen the fee note. The fee note was correctly provided to the defendant, and that appears at in tab 5 after page 12.
Mm.
And so I'll pause in case the defendant has any further submissions on that fee note.
Thank you. So, are we accepting the fees?
Yes,
thank you.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. If we can move on to item 38, tab 5, page 10.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You'll see this is where the claimants have a particular concern about new points being raised by the defendant at this stage.
Mm.
You see here in item 38 that the points are discrete at the bottom. The defendant concedes. The defendant has not fully particularised the challenges to the time spent on documents, but reserved the right to do so in the event that this matter proceeds to assessment, and will provide an appendix to these points, which will provide a line-by-line review of each team member's time. Of course, no such document was provided, despite your indications here at tab 8,
mm-hmm.
Which said, I require the defendant's submission now that it has seen the claimant's concessions,
mm-hmm.
and also despite our email at tab 10 of the 17th of May 2015, where we raised this very concern.
Mm-hmm.
No submissions have been made by the defendant, and we submit that the defendant should be strictly limited in any submissions that they make today on this point of dispute. We have already made a significant correction concession in respect of the time spent on documents in connection with the 5th of February 2015 order.
Mm-hmm.
We obviously stand by that concession and correction, but save for that point, we say that the sum claimed under item 38 should stand. I'll pause for Mr. Gassett to make submissions.
Again, court.
Could you give me a second? Mr. Gassett, thank you.
Now, the court, in deciding whether or not well, the factors required for the court to consider the 38, part 38 and 29, is not something that's contingent upon the defendant providing a line-by-line review of the items. The court is able to look at the bill of costs and make a determination about whether it has sufficient information to either approve that time or amend it. When you look at, for example, the level of detail, and again, the global submission I'm making is that the level of detail is not sufficient for me to be completely satisfied that the amount of time spent was actually spent on those matters and issues that were required for the litigation. And by way of an example, if I can just address your attention to page 32 of the Bill of Costs.
32.
Yes.
Yeah.
If you look at Eva Cullen's time entry for right at the bottom of the page, 12 minutes, you see the level of detail included in the work that was completed.
You'd have thought it would take her 12 minutes to write that, wouldn't you?
And look at the next page, which for 42 minutes. The court knows that this is what was done. And you're satisfied that that time seems fairly reasonable.
Yes, I take your point. I'm looking back over the bill of costs,
yes.
And there's quite a level of detail there. Yeah.
And when looking at the other time entries, 7 hours, at 9 hours, particularly in relation to, if I can turn your attention at page 17, that Mr. Francis' entry of 9 hours and 18 minutes, finalising his schedule.
Hang on one second, I'm not. Page 17.
Page 17.
Mm-hmm. That time's been conceded. That's relation to the.
It's okay. Let's Mr. Gassett get through, and then we'll.
So 9 hours, 18 minutes. You see that, finalising the skeleton, reviewing, rather than preparing for hearing. Now, what was done to finalise the skeleton? Was it to finalise the conclusion? Was it to a review, including counsel? Was it a group discussion about the skeleton? What was it about? Now, reviewing hearing bundles, assuming that Mr. Francis was actively involved in preparing the hearing bundle, what was there to review? Preparation for hearing, what did that include? Did that include collating information, or did it include strategic meetings with counsel? That you're just not given enough information to give you complete satisfaction that all that time, the 9 hours, was reasonably spent for the purposes of the litigation. And if I can take that
And I think what would help me is if we were to go through the point item 38. Which begins on page 13. I would think that, although you may not have been able to have instructions, which is why your client wasn't able to respond up until now, you've come into court with particular concerns over some elements of the time. And if you want to take us to those particular concerns within item 38, we can look at them. It would be more common in this situation for us to be looking at line items with the paying party having raised a concern. For example, the common one is, why would it take so long to draft a witness statement? When it's the witness's statement, that's the more common complaint. And the court would have had the benefit at that time, with the point having been raised by the paying party, to have looked over the relevant information. Now, we're not in a position today because the specific points are going to go through, but I'm not going to be as strict as the receiving party has asked me to be. I would like you to have the opportunity, if you have flagged in here particular concerns, for us to have a look at them, and then we'll have to come out with the conclusion on the entire point, because that was the point that you have contested in the broad sense. But I would like you, if you've got notes of them, to flag particular items in here that you feel are unreasonable or disproportionate, unreasonable and disproportionate, I suppose, that we can look at, please.
So the problem that we have is that I can't say that these time entries are unreasonable or disproportionate. What I'm saying is that you're not given sufficient information to give you confidence to give the time it's claimed.
Mm.
And it's a global thing. It happens on each and every entry.
Mm.
So there's an issue with the way, with the quality of the time entry. That's what I'm saying. When you look at Ms. Cullen's entries, you know what you're getting for your 48 minutes, for your 10 hours.
But isn't it fair to say that I have more information on the part of the receiving party than I do have information of concern on behalf of the paying party in front of me? At least I have some information from the receiving party. I don't have anything from the paying party setting out their specific concerns about, for example, the number of hours it's taken to prepare.
You don't need to.
I don't need to.
You
okay.
don't need to. And the reason you don't need to is that the onus is on the party preparing the bill of costs to give a sufficient explanation for those costs. You simply don't have it.
Isn't the onus on you to object to them, though?
Well, we have.
Okay, so it's a broad objection, global objection.
It's a broad objection.
I
would say that given the lack of detail, is the court just going to say, well, I accept it? Is this acceptable for time entries to be done in this way for assessment purposes? Should not time be entered at the beginning of the trial with this in mind? I mean, certainly the Ms. Cullen, who's a trainee, demonstrate it to be sufficiently robust and descriptive in her time entries. I mean, that should be applied equally across the board. So the court feels comfortable to give the amount sought. There's not much I can do. You know, if I go through line by line, I simply don't know what was done and what wasn't done. I can't criticise the lack of information. If it was, for example, drafting a 13-page witness statement that's taken 7 hours, I can object to that. Because I can have a statement and then go, well, over here I simply do not have anything.
Well, that I'm not sure I'm with you on that. When I reviewed this for the purposes of drafting the email, I did feel able to get a sense of the time spent, for example, on bundling, preparation, drafting. I mean, I didn't feel uncomfortable that it was that opaque.
For example, here I've got on page 14,
yeah,
at entry of 19th of January, we've got 6 hours, 6 minutes,
yeah.
I think it's the fourth entry. Reviewing hearing bundled papers, amending document production tables, reviewing correspondence, reviewing additional papers. Well, there's a reference to papers, how many? Two pages or four volumes? I simply don't know. I simply don't know. How can I criticise reviewing hearing bundle papers? Do they include the hearing bundle papers for the hearing of the 18th of December, or do they include the hearing bundle papers for the application that's just been filed for the unless orders? I simply don't know.
The opportunity they normally to take line by line and to question the receiving party is in the making of points of dispute. And your clients had a second bite at the cherry to come back. I did invite you to give more particularisation, and you may not have been able to gain instructions at that level of specificity until now. We are now looking, and the determination we're making is on item 38 and the matters that we have before us in terms of your points of dispute and the claimant's response,
yes,
and your submissions today. And those are, as you say, global or general,
yes, they are.
Points.
And the court cannot be... I mean, there needs to be sufficient information for your registrar as the assessor to make a decision or make a determination in accordance with Part 38.21.
But also within the context of 38.23, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you see? That's why I wanted to take us to those as well. Those are also important.
Yes, in relation to that, the conduct of the parties during the course of the trial is something that's relevant to the overall assessment.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of what's in front of you,
yeah,
can you be comfortable that what is being claimed is reasonable and proportionate in pursuant to the rules, despite the lack of information?
Mm.
And that's not for me to, in a way, it's a double-edged sword. If I sought to indicate to the claimants, well, you know, I've got an issue with that, I've got an issue with this, there'll be further work involved, and it's contrary to the objects of the Act, and, there's an obligation on the party preparing the bill of costs to do it in a way and in a method that complies with the rules, that the court can feel safe that it can make that determination in accordance with the rules. At the moment, you simply can't do it, and my friend would like you to criticise us for not raising these objections, but the information is not there for you to be totally satisfied. That's what I'm submitting. It's insufficient.
Insufficient information.
So how does one cure that? I can't cure it by raising the objection 3 or 4 weeks earlier.
Mm.
This is a bill of costs they're relying upon. Why should I say anything more about that?
Mm.
If I can assist you any further on that, those are my submissions in relation to that.
Thank you.
So some very brief points in response. Mr. Gatick has confirmed in his submissions that he cannot say that the time spent, the costs claimed in respect of documents, is unreasonable or disproportionate. They said in their points of dispute, the defendant said in the points of dispute, they would give a line-by-line critique of the time and cost spent on documents. They failed to do that. They failed to do that in response to your email, sir. They failed to do that in response to our email requesting a direction. They have failed again today to identify any specific points of dispute in submissions. So you raised the point about whether or not the defendant has had an opportunity to provide instructions to his lawyers in respect to this item. We said that there's no assertion and certainly no evidence.
It could be one of many reasons, but it's not material.
Of course. So you've identified and we agree with the point that the bill of costs is not opaque or short on detail. Again, it's been prepared by a specialist cross draftsman, senior cross lawyer in London. Mm. This is the level of detail that is customary before the English courts. We say that should be acceptable for the DIFC courts. What you're being invited to do here today, sir, is for the court to spend hearing time going through going through a bill of costs to identify of its own volition items which require further explanation or which may be challenged. That's not a good use of court time, we say, sir. And we have already made a substantial concession accepting that there would be some sort of reduction.
4%. I'd move away from substantial, but you've made a concession.
Of $16,205.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we've been inviting specific points of dispute to respond to. If we're going to fight this category on general and unspecified terms, we say that's unsatisfactory, but there are a couple of points that I would like to make on general terms. We prepared three witness statements of Mr. Kadri, three written statements of Mr. Mostert.
No, it's okay. It's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Well, we've conducted a very brief exercise of looking through the judgment to see how many references there have been made to our witness evidence and the references that Deputy Chief Justice made to the witness evidence of the defendant. There are numerous references to all of the witness statements of the claimant. In the judgment, despite having submitted witness statements from six witnesses, only Mr. Rella's witness statements have any mention in the judgment. So we say the time spent on documents, at least in terms of witness statements, was of assistance to the court at trial, and we say the defendant's witness statements were not of assistance to the court, yet we had to deal with all of those witness statements in our responses. So that's the conclusion of my submissions and response.
Well, the point that we have to determine is whether the claim of 844.1 hours, which is item 38 of the bill of costs, less the concession of 16,205.50 off an initial claim $422,593, a concession of 4%. Whether that amount is reasonable and proportionate in amount and was reasonable and proportionately incurred. To do that, we have submissions, rather, we have a bill of cost which has some level of detail. Although the point is made, some level of detail from pages 13 through to the end of point 38. On page 34. The point is made by Mr. Gassick that the level of detail within the bill of costs is not sufficient for the court to make a determination as to whether the time spent was reasonable and proportionate. And that is a point that was touched upon in the defendant's, or rather the paying party's, point of dispute. The defendant didn't go into greater specificity about the items contained within the pages or so of descriptor for the purposes of drafting their points of dispute, and also didn't take up the invitation to do so set out in my email of the 9th of April, although I am happy to concede that that email does not specifically ask the paying party to do so. And the paying party was once again invited to take us to the specifics within item 38 that caused their concern about proportionality and reasonableness. That invitation was objected to by the receiving party, but the objection was not upheld, and the invitation was extended. The paying party was not, the paying party rather relied on the general point made in the points of dispute. So the question for us is whether the amount claimed for point 38, less the concession, is reasonable and proportionate in amount, and whether it was reasonably and proportionately incurred. And in light of the case, and in light of the points at rule 38.23, I find that it was, and accept the amount claimed less the concession made.
Thank you, sir. Hopefully we can go through the remaining points on the bill of costs quite swiftly. Item 39 is in respect of the cost of preparing the bill of costs, tab 5, page 10 in the points of dispute and responses. Your indication, sir, at tab 8 is I'm inclined towards 30 hours, which we interpret as being 30 hours of the cost drafting time only, which would amount to a deduction of $7,140. The claimants are prepared to accept that figure for item 39. I'll pause for the defendant to consider whether that's acceptable or to make any submissions.
No submissions.
Address points 40 and 42 before you so make any determination on item 39, because it's a related point. This concerns the cost of reviewing and finalising the bill of costs by members of our notaries team. The defendant has offered 2 hours of partner time in at tab 5, page 12. So your indication at tab 8, I'm inclined towards the defendant's concession. The claimants are prepared to accept that figure, which amounts to a further deduction of $4,330. From the bill of costs item. So again, I'll pause again just to confirm that there's no further submissions of that from the defendant.
No further submissions from us.
So you're in a position to make a determination on item 39, 40 and 42.
Do I need to make a decision on it?
Well, just to confirm your initial indications, if you're in a position to do so.
Well, you've got agreement now as to the concession.
Yes. Then that brings us to a conclusion in respect of the substantive bill of costs. Of course, we are claiming our costs of the detailed assessment proceedings, which I'll hand up to you, sir. This is a claim for the cost of the detailed assessment proceedings from after the date of the bill of costs. The claim is for $27,195. My colleague is just calculating what further deductions have been made by the court today in addition to the concessions that the claimants have made. But it should be readily apparent that the claimants have substantially achieved the large majority of their costs claimed by the date of the points of dispute and responses. It's taken some 6 months from the date of the bill of costs to this hearing, and that has incurred additional time in advising the claimants and the need to continually refamiliarise the team with the detail of the bill of costs and point of dispute. We've had to arrange documents for the hearing and a bundle for the hearing and documents electronically, just in case any specific points of dispute were raised during the hearing, which has increased the costs. And we've also had to prepare the hearing without the defendant having set out any detailed submissions in advance, despite the number of requests. And on that basis, we submit that it's reasonable and proportionate to maintain and defend the cost claim for over $600,000 at a cost of $27,195. We also have, without prejudice, correspondence which we can address before you, sir. Which I'll hand up now. This is. If I can just get the right rule. So I'm just trying to find the rule in the DRC Courts Rules which concerns WP offers at this stage. Yes, sir, it's rule 40.46 and rule 40.47. And 44.47 is the relevant provision, which states the fact of the offer must not be communicated to the court until the question of costs of the detailed assessment proceedings falls to be decided. Now, so the claimants were concerned to avoid the inconvenience and cost of these proceedings and made WP offer. The other purpose of making that WP offer at an early stage was to allow the claimants to proceed with enforcement proceedings without delay. That is why the offer was extremely generous to the defendant. We actually offered to settle the costs at a figure of $425,000, which is obviously substantially less than we've achieved today. And on that basis, we say we should be entitled to recover all of the costs in our statement of costs, so the full sum of $27,195. So it's evident that the defendant should accept that offer, but instead has elected to put us to the trouble of these proceedings and the risk of enforcement at a later stage.
Thank you.
The defendants during the very January all the time has been discussions about what put on notice that our client would make an appeal. And the matter involves the right of one party who unilaterally benefits from terminating the contract, benefiting from exercising that unilateral right. Effectively, it was a transfer of my client's shares over to one of the other shareholders for zero value. Court made a determination, that was it. Our client felt that he needed to go to an appeal and take it, and that's why it was refused. Why the offer was rejected, because there were appeal rights which were not yet exhausted. So if my friend wants to rely on an offer, it ought to have been after all of the appeal avenues were exhausted, in my respectful submission, for it to be one that should have been reasonably made, because the appeal process wasn't exhausted. That's all I can say.
Isn't this well? Okay, thank you. Do you want to comment at all on the statement of costs that's just been handed up?
Yeah,
okay.
I just wanted to clarify. I know my friend made considerable concessions in the amount of $16,000. There was another concession in the amount of $30,000.
Yes, that's right. I'll say no more than I'm concerned at the way in which your client has chosen to conduct these cost proceedings. In light of our practice direction number 5, in light of the letter which has just been passed up to me of the 6th of January, in light of the way in which it prosecuted point 38, probably the most significant point within the points of dispute, but clients prosecute cases in different ways, I'll say no more than it troubles me. In relation to statement of costs, I find costs in favour of the receiving party, and I don't have submissions to suggest that the fees are unreasonable or disproportionate, so I allow them.
Thank you, sir. I'll move on to the cost order under the order of Mr. Justice Steele, dated 27th of April 2015, which appears at tab 2 is the order, and then tab 6 is the statement of costs. The claim is for $20,227 and have very brief submissions on the reason for that level of costs. The defendant submitted a sizable volume of documents as part of this application. There was a 10-page witness statement / expert report from the Altamini senior partner, Mr. Sam Altamini, with an exhibit that was 208 pages long. That exhibit, I would add, did have a lot of very familiar documents in it. So I'm not saying it's new documents, but again, it had to be reviewed. There was an 8-page skeleton argument from the defendant's trial QC. It was a very unusual application, which raised arguments based on the UAE constitution, which needed to be researched. It was high stakes for the claimants, since the Chief Justice had decided not to dismiss it on an ex parte basis. So despite our belief that it was a very weak application, we were concerned that it had not been rejected by the Chief Justice on an ex parte basis, and therefore we were alerted that we needed to deal with this application in detail. We were invited to prepare written submissions in response. We prepared a 15-page written statement, which I prepared myself with assistance from the junior associate, Mr. Duji, who's by my side here today, with 35 pages of exhibits. Justice Steele agreed with the arguments set out in the claimant's written submissions. In short, the defendant's application was misconceived and hopeless, and dismissed on that basis.
Did he use those words?
No, he didn't. So
okay.
And we don't have the reasons for his order before the court today. However, what he did say is that there were fundamental problems with the defendant's application in that it did not address the correct text, which was the heart of our submissions. We went a bit further, using prejudicial language to say that was misconceived and hopeless, but in essence, he agreed with the point that they did not address the correct test for this application to get off the ground. On that basis, we say a sum of $20,227 is reasonable and proportionate for the work involved.
And remind me the nature of the application. Was this the unless? No.
This was an application under Rule 44179 from memory. Let me see if I've got that right. Yes, it was, in essence, an application to reopen a final determination of the DIS on the basis there was some sort of injustice.
I remember. So it was the paying party's application to reopen, and the cost we're talking about are the cost that you incurred by choosing to defend that application.
Well, we were invited to submit a written statement in response, and yes, the cost of responding.
So the court invited you to do so?
Yes, sir. Chief Justice. Sir.
Chief Justice did. Right. Thank you. Mr. Cassidy.
The only thing I could say to that is that as this is an evolving jurisdiction, there are certain questions which may arise that can lead to perhaps a further development of the law in this area. And one of those is whether or not someone can take the property of another person without just compensation. That's one of the issues that we raised in the constitutional point. And certainly because there were some competing views about whether or not, in effect, an English judge could make a determination on a question involving the constitution and its operation, and some discussions about the other judges of this court indicating that, you know, when there are UAE issues, Emirati qualified judges are in the best place to make those sort of decisions, then obviously the application lent itself to perhaps a review outside of the DIFC in order to get some fuller understanding or fuller teasing out of principles that concern whether or not, first of all, the Constitution, Article 21 of the Constitution, relates to corporations or the government or individuals. So it's certainly an application that was not wholly without merit. We will look at the development jurisdiction of this court.
Well, but the way you paint the application is a bit different to the way I just heard it. Wasn't the application to do with rehearing a decision of
the... Yes, but it involved, as I understand it, it involved these constitutional points.
So those were the arguments that were advanced by the defendant in support of the application, but the rule is very clear, and the case law is very clear. It requires some injustice or evidence of injustice.
Just take me to the rule again. I misplaced it.
44.179, and... says the Court of Appeal or the Court of First Instance will not reopen a final determination of any appeal unless it is necessary to do so in order to avoid real injustice. That's the key.
We did see some of these attempts come through. So we had a Court of Appeal final decision, and this was an application for a rehearing of the Court of Appeal decision.
Yes, sir.
Because the constitutional points it was felt needed to be had led to an injustice.
Yes.
Yeah.
The effective. Of someone confiscating another's property without just compensation, and this is the effect of the contract in question, allows Mr. Cadre, one of the claimants, to unilaterally terminate a contract, thus effectively taking away the shareholding of my client in the business.
So it was actually quite a complex point. UA constitution and...
Yes.
And it was actually a very important point because... that the outcome of that point could have been determinative of the underlying case.
That's exactly right.
So that leads us towards expecting a higher bill from your counterparty, because, as you say, it's a complex matter which is fundamental to the case.
No, it was. When you say complex, I mean, our position was is that the decision, I mean, was such that the effect of this contract was a confiscation of property without just compensation. So, and given that there was an interpretation of UAE law by a non-qualified Emirati judge, that could potentially impact upon what the Attorney General may or may not decide to do. I understand that is a still a live question, because the application has been made to the Attorney General, and we simply don't know what the status of the Attorney General's decision is, whether it declines to refer the case under politicisation or not.
Well, that's not a matter for today. What's a matter for today is whether the $20,227.52 were reasonably proportionately incurred. And the way you've described it to me is...
I think it's important for the court to know that these issues are not...
But let's just focus on this. And the way you've painted this is a really important point that you've raised. That steers me towards suggesting that I would have expected a no-fee spent time.
I understand that, yes. I mean, there are issues. And I can't... around that or above it or around it. I think that would be important to put before you what the position is.
Thank you. So where are you on this statement of costs which we're being asked to assess?
I can't comment on it.
No submissions?
No submissions, I can't. No submissions.
Well, in the absence of submissions, then we allow the bill of costs.
Thank you, sir. We'll move on to the last matter for the hearing today. It's the cost order by the very recent order of Judge Omar and Harry.
I don't have any papers on this, by the way.
Well, it's not surprising because it was actually issued yesterday. The same costs was put in paper form. At the front, you've got the order, and the costs order is at number 5 on page 2 of the order. The defendant has consented to it being assessed today, and since we do have time today, we suggest we've got more than ample time to determine this.
Can we have 10 minutes so I can look over this?
Of course,
please.